Hey guys, Eckhart Slaughter here. Hello and welcome to another episode of Star Wars Who Would Win, the series where we take two ships from the Star Wars universe, put them head to head, and try to predict which one would come out on top. We got what I consider to be a pretty fun episode today because it's kind of revisiting a matchup that we looked at very early on in this series' history. A few videos ago, a user by the name of Allah Akbar suggested that I put the Malevolence, which was a Subjugator Class Heavy Cruiser, against the Executor Class Super Star Destroyer. As I'm sure most of you guys know, this battle is interesting because the Malevolence has a specialized ion cannon, which can be used to disable enemy ships. The Malevolence was featured relatively early on in this series' history when it went against the Bellator-class Super Star Destroyer. It was my opinion in that matchup that because the Bellator is built for speed, it should be able to actually avoid the ion cannon. The Executor is a much, much different class of ship, so I don't know if that will necessarily be possible, and if it can avoid the ion cannon, will it still survive? That's the question we're going to be looking at today. Also, just as a little plug, the first chapter of my new Star Wars What If series features a Bellator class Super Star Destroyer, so if you guys are interested in big Star Wars ships, you might like that, and I'll put a link down in the description. So today we're going to be looking at these two ships and comparing them in three different categories: firepower, defensive capabilities, and fighter carrying capacity. However, this isn't a race to see which ship can win more categories. We're looking at the battle overall, and we'll be looking at intangibles in order to select the best ship possible. Other than that, I just want to say that we're looking at a standard Executor and standard Malevolence, no special upgrades, and that we're presuming that each ship is piloted by equally skilled persons. Finally, I just want to say that I will be pulling from Star Wars Legends for this matchup, though I will do so in a restrained way. Alright, so let's first look at weaponry, and again, we've got two vastly different ships here. The Executor Class Super Star Destroyer is filled with conventional turbolaser batteries. With over 5,000 turbolaser cannons, heavy turbolaser cannons, missile launchers, ion cannons, and other weaponry, an Executor Class Super Star Destroyer could literally slag the surface of a planet in several hours. The ship also notably had a dedicated point defense laser system. This was meant to help protect against starfighters that got too close to the ship. The Executor was decently laid out and organized. Because of its wedge shape, most of the firepower could flow through the front of the ship. This means that an enemy would be hit with most of the Executor's weapons if it was in a certain area. However, that being said, there were of course some blind spots. Up close to the ship, behind the ship, if you were in these spots, it would be difficult for the Super Star Destroyer to hit you. Also, because of the large size of the ship, and because like the Death Star, it used trenches, if a starfighter got too close to the Executor, it might be able to avoid the point defense turrets. However, thankfully, as we'll get to later, the Executor carried its own complement of starfighters. Alright, so now let's look at the Malevolence, and at 4,845 meters, this Subjugator Class Heavy Cruiser was only 1/4 of the size of the Executor Class Super Star Destroyer. The main attraction of the Malevolence were dual ion cannons, and these quasi-super weapons were powerful enough to disable several Venator-class Star Destroyers. So the Malevolence would charge its ion cannons and fire it. The weapon would shoot out a circular kind of arc, which would disable any ships that were unlucky enough to get caught in its path. Luckily, the projectile did move pretty slowly, and the weapon did take some time to recharge, so starfighters and other smaller ships could avoid it. Other than that, the Malevolence was conventionally well-armed, at least for its size and for its era. It was one of the most powerful ships during the Clone Wars. However, with less than 1,000 ion cannons and point defense cannons, it really can't stand up in a straight slugging match with the Executor. At least, that is to say, without its ion cannon. But I'm not really going to go into how that would actually play into this battle. I'll do so when we get to the final matchup. For now, because the ion cannon kind of throws a wrench into things, I'm going to call this category a tie. Next, we have defensive capabilities, and well, the Executor is clearly a very durable ship, and it's obviously stronger than the Malevolence. That being said, the Confederate ship was relatively difficult to take down, and was only finally destroyed after it was flown into a moon. I'll speak more to the Executor's shielding and its power when we get to the actual matchup, but I do right now just want to point out one instance where three Star Destroyers came out of hyperspace literally right on top of the Super Star Destroyer. The Executor's shields tanked these three ships without any serious damage being done. Other than that, I just should mention that both of these ships have super overexposed bridges, which, again, just such a bad decision when you're designing a capital ship. It basically screams, shoot me right here, and you can kill everyone that's important. All right, so let's very quickly now look at starfighters. And we know that the Executor, at least typically, carried 144 starfighters. Now, if you guys watch this channel, you know that I totally disagree with that number and think it's way, way, way too low for a ship of that size, but it's what we're gonna go with today. We don't know the exact fighter complement of the Malevolence. Personally, I wouldn't be surprised if it was at the 100, 150 mark. So just to keep things interesting, I'll give them 144 fighters. Really, I also don't think fighters are gonna be a very important part of this battle. It's gonna come down to, really, whether the Executor can survive being hit from the Malevolence's ion cannon. So with that being said, and with that still in your mind, let's look straight at the battle. We'll skip intangibles and just kind of wrap everything up here. The Confederacy of Independent Systems and their Malevolence appears in the middle of empty space. Right in front of it is the Executor Class Superstar Destroyer. Which ship wins? The Executor Class Superstar Destroyer has the weaponry to completely annihilate the Malevolence in a few minutes. However, in those few minutes, I do not doubt at all that the Malevolence will be able to get its ion cannon off and that the Executor will not be able to avoid it. And this is once again the crux of the matchup. What happens when that ion cannon is fired? Unlike with the Bellator, we're not looking at whether the ship can avoid it, but we're looking at what happens when the Executor is actually hit. I think we can even further distill or rephrase this question. Does the Executor have the ability to survive the ion cannon blast? I think the first thing we need to look at is the power of the ion cannon. I mean, we've seen it used a couple of times, once to take down three Venator class star destroyers and another time to take out some frigates. However, the Venator is much, much, much smaller than the Executor class super star destroyer, almost 100 times smaller in fact. And kind of appropriately then, the Executor's energy output is 2 magnitudes higher than that of a single Venator. So the question's been further delineated now. Can the Malevolence actually zap the energy from a ship that is 100 times more powerful than the most powerful thing that we've seen it take down? One thing that I thought was really interesting when I was re-watching scenes for this episode is that the size of the ship being hit by the Malevolence's weapon determines the actual effects of the ion cannon. We see with starfighters or even the small medical transports that once they're hit by the weapon, the ships are completely disabled. There's no secondary lights, no power whatsoever. However, when a Venator is hit, we can still see that many of the ship's functions are still operational. Lights are still on, sensors are still running, although they appear to be malfunctioning, and escape pods are able to be launched, although that could arguably be purely mechanical. In other words, it's clear that the actual effects of the ion cannon depend on the size of the ship, and while that may be obvious, it's still probably useful to say. The Executor puts up a shield that is 100 times more powerful than anything the Malevolence has ever encountered. It has a tremendous amount of energy, and I really don't think that a simple ion cannon will be able to totally disable the ship. I think the best case scenario for the Separatists is that the ion cannon shot manages to disable or harm a few of the Executor systems. Maybe the shield stops working as effectively, or some of the gun systems get sizzled out, but I don't even really think that that's likely. I think what will happen is that the Executor will tank the shot with minimal damage. I mean, maybe its shields get drained a little bit, but nothing serious. At that point, the Malevolence starts recharging its cannon, because maybe a second shot will actually do some serious damage. Of course, it's also going to be firing with its turbo lasers, and it will also send out its fighters. By this point, I think the Executor's 6,000 weaponry systems will now be bearing down on the Malevolence. This is the kind of firepower that the ship was never meant to go up against. And in my mind, the Malevolence will be almost immediately completely shredded by just an overwhelming amount of weaponry. We've seen that the cannons also are weak points when they've just fired or are preparing to fire, so the Separatists really have no hope here. There's overwhelming fire coming from the Executor, and in this case, I think its traditional weapons and its overwhelming shielding and power generation beat the kind of gimmicky weapons of the Separatists. I really do think that the Malevolence gets wiped across the floor in this matchup. I mean, we see the Executor get hit by 3 Star Destroyers coming out of hyperspace right on top of it, and its shields hardly flicker. I mean, we're dealing with an insane amount of energy. I give this battle to the Executor, and I think it wins 9.95 times out of 10. As I said, it's one of the most powerful weapons ever created in galactic history, and I don't believe there's anything that the Malevolence Malevolence can do to take down its shields. The amount of power produced is just way, way too high. But that is just one man's opinion. I would love to hear what you guys think. Take a second right now to vote in the upper right-hand corner and let me know which ship you think would come out on top. Also, go down to the comments, let me know if you think I did a good job, if I missed something, if I'm not giving the Ion Cannon enough credit and you don't think that the Superstar Destroyer would be able to take one of its blasts, anything else. I know you guys are usually pretty quick at this, but also make sure to put your matchups down in the comments. And if you see a matchup that you like, give it a thumbs up and a supporting comment, because that is how I choose the topics for my next videos. If you guys want to further support the channel, you can follow me on Twitter, join the Discord, which is a whole lot of fun, and it's just reached 260 users, or you can donate on my GoFundMe page at gofundme.com/Eckhart's Ladder. I'm going to post a formal update in just a few days, but I want to give a very special thank you to Alex Tandy. Alex donated $460 to my campaign. Because of his help and because of everyone else who donated, I've met my first goal, and I will now be able to buy a new microphone and probably a new computer. I'm gonna keep raising money, but at this point, everything is just a bonus. So thank you, Alex, and everyone else who donated, really. Can't say enough, guys. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. If you haven't donated or you don't have the money to donate, please do not feel bad. I really just appreciate you guys visiting my channel, watching my videos, leaving your really, really nice comments and constructive feedback, and sharing my content with your friends and family. I feel like the community has really been coming together over the past few days, and I've really enjoyed not only doing this Versus series, but also my other series as well. So thanks again, guys, and hey, as always, may the Force be with you.